it's not showing my presentation on it, which I have kept open.
Ma'am, did you select the start sharing button, ma'am?
Yeah, and I say share and it shows you on it.
Select entire screen, ma'am.
Yeah, that's what I have done. Select entire screen.
Okay, and then click on the share button.
Yeah. That is sharing.
Yeah.
No, your it is screen.
No, no, ma'am. It is now. Yeah, yeah. And now you can minimize this and open your PowerPoint. We are able to see your.
Okay. Yeah. Has it come now?
Yeah, it has come. You can make it full screen.
Full screen. Okay. Okay. So. Everywhere, every meeting related to education today, from pre-primary to higher education, the trend, the talk is NEP 2020. So all the work that the country is doing in different parts is all related to NEP 2020. And most of you who have gone through NEP 2020 will also see there are a lot of promises for all children to learn. See the blue highlight that I have made here. To contribute to directly transform India. That's the key word now. We are anyway in the whole world. The highest youth population is in India, in the whole world. And giving the right education to all of them, however diverse they are in their learning requirements, meet their needs by providing high quality education. This is a very important term, the quality here, and high quality education, and thereby making India a global knowledge superpower. I'm sure all of you teachers are eager to do that, and all of you teachers are with me and the nation to see that we mold our younger generation despite their learning differences that they are likely to have. Take them all with us to give the best to our children, so tomorrow's India is really the envisioned knowledge superpower, global knowledge superpower that we see here. So again, the policy also states that the principle that education must develop not only cognitive capacity. The key word here, because we are now addressing, your group is now talking about children with intellectual disabilities and their education. So this sentence I find very meaningful. Cognitive capacities, yes. Essential. We, how much ever cognitive capacity these children have, we need to polish it and give them the best to bring out their potential. But the policy gives us options. You see that not only cognitive capacities, by literacy, numeracy, skills or higher order cognitive capacities, there are those who are incapable of that, you see, because of the intellectual impairment that they have. We also focus on social, ethical, emotional capacities and disposition. Jo very beautifully said, you see, that we need to address not only chadu ledu, 10th class variki ella potaru ma babu, itla 5th class variki kuda raledu inka, raayadam raadu, chadavadam raadu. See, the parents constantly, the teachers when they talk to me, constantly what they say is parents demand. Because we are also all these days focusing only on the literacy and numeracy skills. And we were giving marks to children based on how they perform in the five subjects of English language, math, science and social studies. And that decided, quote unquote, how bright the child is or how dull the child is. That is the education system. Now the NEP is giving us silver lining there. Maybe the dawn is not very, very far. That not only focus on that, but also look at the other issues, other areas in the child, and try to sharpen that. Maybe not so good with the academic skills of reading, writing, but maybe very good at something else, and he's going to excel tomorrow. Who knows? But it is the teacher's job to identify the strengths in the child and develop those strengths in the manner that we are preparing tomorrow's citizen who is going to contribute as he grows up. You know, he's a citizen today too, but as a citizen of India in a contributing age, he may be doing his best to make the country better. So beautifully said, very important sentence I find. Reading writing, yes, but reading writing is not all. That's what we are trying to highlight here. It's in the page 4. Now, another important point that is there, in all the subsection on 6 onwards is all the subsection containing everything on 6 is to do with children who are having special needs or having socio-culturally, economically deprived children, related things. In that, 6.2.5 talks about importance of creating enabling mechanism so that the Divyang students get same opportunity of obtaining quality education as any other child. It's a very, very important point to remember. Same opportunity. There are many places where they don't get the opportunity to learn. You know, school is far away. All of us know primary education, there are a large number of children enrolled because the primary schools are within their village. Secondary education, many drop out because of lack of transport, especially so if the child is having non-ambulatory issues, you know, doesn't walk. How long parents can take him some 7-8 kilometers far away to the school and bring him back. So transport has become one of the issues or reasons for the child to drop out. Many girls with the intellectual disability in the villages, they stop from going to school. The family stops them from going to school because after they attain menarche, they think it's, number one, not safe to go to school. Number school, the school's toilets are not equipped with the basic facilities of water. So the girls themselves are not comfortable going to the school. These have been issues we are facing. So here the highlight on opportunities for quality education includes also the support systems that we provide for them to get the best of education, not just the classroom teaching with the chalk and talk, you know, much, much beyond that. So these one or two slides I just put in to show that how NEP is 2020 is very enhancing and facilitating to see that children get education. Shilpa, if anything is not right, you have to come in and tell me because I don't see anything on the screen except the PowerPoint. So I don't have any indications, okay? Shilpa? Shilpa?
Ma'am.
Yeah. If something is not right, something is not audible, you have to come in somehow and let know because I am having absolutely no clue how it is going. Screen has nothing except the PowerPoint.
Ma'am, do you want me to share the screen?
And is there a problem? Is there a problem right now?
No, there is absolutely no problem. Okay, it is going on.
Fine. It is just that I am not getting any feedback, right? So I can't see anything. I'm okay if it is okay with you all. But you have to tell me if things go wrong.
Yes, sure. Okay. I will.
Okay, thank you. So currently, what we have for our children with disabilities, either they are in the regular schools. Earlier, we had the integrated education, which differs from inclusive education in the sense that the children with disabilities were expected to be prepared by the special educators in a segregated environment, then send them into the classroom. In essence, the regular teacher did not have a role to play except having them learn with others. How they learn is the preparation, depending on the preparation that the special educators have made and sent them into classroom. So obviously this had its own disadvantages. So that got later with another support system of resource education, where the children part of the time got the support from the resource teacher from segregated environment, and part of the time they were in the inclusive classroom, depending upon which areas required need and which areas were okay by themselves. And then comes in your inclusive education that we are going through today. So inclusive education basically is where the responsibility of education lies with the class teacher, and the class teacher is expected to teach the child. And the class teacher will be given the support systems, including the special educator support, method, material, evaluation, all those, the class teacher gets support from the special educator. Most of you in Siksha, you know exactly what you are doing, the kind of support you are giving in, to each of the teachers depending upon the needs of the children. So this is being implemented, but all of us know the number of special educators to reach all our children is minimum in our country. It is not adequate, and each of you tend to have 5 to 8 schools, such that to one school you go once or twice in a month, which is much, 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 much below the requirement. Anyhow, we have made a beginning and it is happening, which is a good sign. And the most unexpected thing that has happened now is also the additional load on you all teachers on home learning teaching that you are doing, that home learning through using the gadgets and cell phones and other things. So that is another thing that has come on to you and you are all coping very well. Other than that, within the system, what we had is a home-based instruction. COVID-19 or no COVID-19, there were a large number of children whom you were reaching home and teaching them. Go there and then in the home environment, identifying a teacher, quote-unquote teacher, within the classroom, maybe the mother, maybe the father, maybe the sibling, maybe the grandmother. So you've been giving the home-based instruction. So currently, these are the systems that we are going through in our country. And there is this concept of universalization of education that has come in. And origin of this universalization of education has again come into action points that includes universal design for learning. So universal, the word universal, the moment you say, it is being tried out globally. Universalization of education, when we said primary education, UEE, when we are using the term, that means the whole world, UN declared that all children will have primary education. So the UPE or UEE, Universalization of Elementary Education or Universalization of Primary Education, was in place, and that's how the enrollment increased. Now, the UDL is a concept that is spreading all over the world. Universal design for learning. So the universal design, the term universal design was used initially when accessibility was created to persons with disabilities in the form of ramps, in the form of, as you see, the toilet adaptations, and then the door opening adaptation, the touch screen, all persons with disabilities should be able to access all facilities that you and I are accessing. That is the idea. People without a disability, whatever we are accessing, they should be able to access, which means that the problem is not with them if they are not accessing. The problem is with us for not providing them the access. You see the paradigm shift in that, you know. All these days, they were considered incapable of doing X, Y, and Z. Today, it is looked at as if they are unable to do, it is because we have not given them the access to do. We have not given them the provision to do. So, you have a class in the second floor and the school does not have a ramp or a lift. The person in wheelchair is not handicapped. You have made him handicapped by not allowing him to reach the first floor. And the material presented, lift, if you go, you will find all the public building lifts have a braille letter also, and audio also, which floor we are in. So a person with vision impairment will be equally able to reach places like you and I are able to reach places using the lift without anybody's help. And the lift car size is also made big in a manner that a wheelchair can go 360 degree round, so that he can on his own maneuver himself to get into the lift and come out of the lift. So these are universal design. Initially, they had the term accessibility for persons with disability, accessibility for persons with disability. Then came the new terminology, universal design for learning, because listen to me carefully here. Those that are designed for them, many of us who are not disabled are finding it easy to use. the ramp, if you are carrying a suitcase going through a ramp, you see the Secunderabad railway station, many railway stations, your stroller luggage is very easy to go through the ramp for you, and you don't need anybody to help you lifting it. It's not just persons with disabilities, but it is you and me. And secondly, the signage is everywhere in public places for indicating where your food is available, water is available, toilet, where it is. There are signages. So even if I do not read Telugu, I will know where is what, because there are signages everywhere. So I believe I don't have a disability, but then I am disabled when it comes to a language that I cannot read, and I am using the facility that is made for perhaps persons with intellectual disability who cannot read, or anybody else who cannot read. The signages are in their places. So you and I are using them. We prepare for them, but you and I are using them. You see? Therefore, the transformation came to the terminology universal design rather than adaptations or accessibility for persons with disability. The usage of accessibility for persons with disability is replaced with universal design, because you and I are learning. You and I are using that, right? So the same concept has led to UDL, the universal design for learning. Now, what do you mean by universal design for learning is that all children in the class must learn. So maybe you create a lesson for a child who has difficulty in learning, whereas many other children in the class who are not termed disabled, but because you have simplified it for the sake of that child, rest of the children also learn. Just like the universal design, the ramp and things meant for persons with disability initially is being used by everybody. So UDL also addresses all children, though you simplify it or modify it, keeping certain children in mind, right? So now look at this picture, functional, this is a borrowed one from CAST. I have given the reference at the bottom. Functional definition of accessibility basically is to provide students the opportunity, number one, to acquire the same information, engage in the same interaction, and enjoy the same services as other students without a disability in your classroom, with substantially equivalent ease of use. Beautifully said. That is UDL. So you simplify it or you modify it, you adapt it in a manner that the child with a certain diverse learning ability in him also learns like others, engages in the task also like others, and he is also able to enjoy the same services that others are getting. This is simply what is UDL, right? I'll give you this analogy. I was just sharing it with somebody in the morning also, in some other context. When you have these big chains in the harbor, you see, that lift thousands of kilos of tons of material on huge big chains on a crane and drops it to another place. Very heavy chains, you can't lift them. And they pick up tons and tons of material with ease with the crane and drops it to another place. Now imagine one link, one small link in that crane is weak or open, little bit open. The whole chain is weak. Just one little link in the thousands and thousands of heavy iron links, one link is little weak. You will find that the whole chain is weak. It cannot be doing the performance as good as the other one. So you are fixing that one link well, so the whole chain gets stronger. So we, the special educators, we are looking at those weaker links to see that we are strengthening the weaker links, in the process of which the whole student chain gets stronger. That is how the UDL works, right? So no more we are looking at deficit in the student. सुनाई नहीं देता, दिखाई नहीं देता, चलने नहीं आता, दिमाग कमजोर है, कम है. सो वी वर ऑलवेज पॉइंटिंग टू द चाइल्ड ऑल दीज डेज. नो मोर लुक एट द डेफिसिट्स नाउ, बट लुक एट द डाइवर्सिटी. इसे ये हो सकता, ये हो सकता, ये हो सकता, ये कर सकता, ये करेगा, मैं ये बच्चा को दूंगी. तो दैट इज द ब्यूटी, द होल शिफ्ट टू हाउ आई रीच द चाइल्ड विद द बेस्ट, इवन इफ ही हैज अ difference in him, a diverse learning need in him, how am I reaching the child? So that is what is the focus today. So we don't look at the deficit and magnify it as that is the whole problem in the person. Instead, that is there, okay, but there are other systems that are functioning well in him and how best they can be used. As I am working also in improving or doing something about the area that is having certain deficit, look at this brighter area, stronger area, so that I can make the child function better. So now, keeping this in mind, you look at your school curriculum. Abhi aap soch rahe hain, lecture acha hai, curriculum ke bare mein batao, how do I do with the curriculum there, and this child sitting in my class and 25 other children in the class, what do I do, how do I teach? That should be working in your mind. Okay, so when you form a lesson for children with diverse learning needs, your major focus, which is already known to you, is the curriculum and the demand on you that you follow that curriculum. By the end of the year, you should have completed this prescribed book, and then there is exam and stuff. Then you look at these children, a few of them in your class, who have these diverse learning needs. And look in each child, first look at the strength in the child. What are all the strengths in him? So you will find that the disability that you are looking at in the child becomes smaller, 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 because you are magnifying the strength of the child. And then you look at the need. Here is the curriculum. Here is the strength of the child. And okay, he cannot see, or he cannot hear, or he is slower to learn. He reverses letters. He cannot read, but he hears, and then he is able to understand what is told. So that kind of deficits, it's not a deficit in him, but certain needs in that child that you have identified. So with the existing curriculum and the strength, how do I compensate and train him to meet his needs? This must be your mantra. This must be your focus. First, the curriculum, the whole class is going to get that. And some children who are not going to learn like others for various reasons, but they have certain other strengths. What are those strengths? And then here is his need. So this content, how is it going to go there? We'll see in a while how to go about. But this should be your line of thinking, rather than, oh, ye bachcha mere class mein, usko to ADHD hai, usko to dimag kam hai, kya karungi, iske sab. So all you look at is his problem, his problem, his problem, right? So instead, slightly change your line of thinking and things fall in place. So when you begin with the general curriculum, make a connection between the general curriculum and the IEP objectives that you have got, and decide what the student will learn in each subject in the class level. What is it that this student is capable of learning, given these are the lessons? There must be certain things that he is capable of learning. Which general curriculum objectives are to be taught? There is many, but there are some that may not be appropriate for him, and you are likely to adapt it, replace it, modify it, substitute it. Yeah? And how to make general curriculum objective meaningful to this student? So if this is the lesson, how do I make it meaningful at his level for this student? This is your thought process now, working with him. Now, you will find first your acceptance, very important. Acceptance that this child has diverse learning needs. He doesn't learn like others, but he will learn through some other method of my taking the content to him. See his strengths. Learn together wherever possible. Many our students teach us a lot. We also learn from them. Remember this. It is not just that we teach. The more difficult it is to get a concept across to a child for us, and finally when he learns after those failures, you are more confident to work with another child having a similar issue. Why? Why was first one difficult? Why is the second one easy for you? Because from the first one's experience, you have learned. So you have become a better teacher. Yeah? So the second one having a similar issue, I know what to do with him. I can manage this. So that confidence comes in. So learn with the child. And learn together also means having all children learning together, not this child segregated to sit with his stuff material and other children do something else. No. It also means peer group come together, and all of them learn, and the teacher also learns along with the children. Then accommodate, where there is a requirement for accommodation, that is existing curriculum, make the method differences. Modification is when the child cannot learn the existing curriculum, we need a different curriculum, then you would modify. You will see better over here. Accommodation, I repeat, accommodation refers to...
Can I stop for a while?
I'll just finish this because next one will see.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Let me see where we can stop. YUDL. Over here we can stop. Can I go up to this?
Yes, ma'am. Sure.
Because this is a continuation of the accommodation modification.
Sure, ma'am.
So we'll stop here and then YUDL will be the second half. Is
sure.
it okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. I'll just finish with what I have started. I agree that I'm also feeling bored looking at the screen, not having any reaction. Yeah. So I will be happy to stop, but let me just finish this that I've started with. Yeah? Shilpa, is it okay?
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely.
Okay. So accommodation is when the curricular content remains the same. You don't change the curricular content because the child's learning needs are different. No, you believe he will be able to manage this if I change my process of teaching towards him. Yeah. Whereas modification is content itself may be not suitable for him, and therefore you have to change the content as well as the methodology of teaching. Now, relate the lesson to the student. How do you do that? Accommodation and modification when we talk about. Goals may be different, but the needs to be related to the lessons in the class. So example, you are seeing an example here. When all children learn how the digestive system functions at class, this is a class 4, and here is a student with ID sitting in this class, and the lesson that you are teaching in science is digestive system. So all children learn completely how the digestive system is functioning. Maybe the child with ID, same lesson he is learning. Maybe the objectives you are fixing for him is to identify or name the major organs involved in the digestive system, starting with your mouth and tongue and teeth and food pipe and stomach. If he is able to identify which are all the organs in the body responsible for digestion, maybe this is class 4 lesson. But this student with ID, you have brought it down to a level in which he'll understand and absorb and retain. But the lesson is still digestive system. You see? So that is where you are accommodating for this child. And you may be teaching him differently, either showing on himself his own body part or using models of the digestive system. Whole class will benefit when you are doing that. That's what you do. For his sake, you would have brought the models. The whole class will benefit by it. When all children look at book and illustration, we may use models for this body. Yeah. And the student may need to work in a different way. That is, when all students write in the notebooks, you may elicit from him oral responses for a reproduction if he has difficulty in writing, or point the parts of the body when you name them. So you may elicit the oral or draw a picture of the digestive system that you have shown. So the input has been modified and the output by the child also has been modified. This is leading towards UDL for you, right? Now, when you accommodate, it is important to keep in mind who's teaching, where the classroom is happening, the teaching experience is happening. Is it happening in a classroom or outdoor or garden, kitchen, wherever? How you are teaching, what materials you are using, and how the students are responding. All of these need to be put together. They are all like cogweaves connected to one another. If one wheel is not rotating, none of the wheels will rotate, the cogwheel that you are seeing. So all of these five have to be synchronized to be successful in teaching, right? So when we first talked about where you teach, so the setting to accommodate a wheelchair or mobility support in the class, how you are organizing the class so that this child is also getting the right comfort level in the classroom so that he can listen to teacher like the rest of the children. Maybe he has vision impairment or hearing impairment or mobility issues. Yeah, the setting, you have to make sure the child is comfortable, and two, know your students and set the ground rules and vary activities. As a teacher, you should be good and competent. Ground rules in the class, these are do's and these are don'ts. This is for all the children in the class. So behavior problems will reduce. You are preventing behavior problems. Vary activity. No, tuck, 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 tuck. Every 10 minutes, see, Shilpa said, shall we have a break for question answer? Your attentions are moving here and there because a long talk continuously. When people like us, then we can have our attention getting diverted. How about the child? So definitely the activities have to vary. That's why Shilpa said, let us have a break and have questions. So the activity varies a little bit, isn't it? Very, very essential for everyone. And then when are you going to have individual attention? When you will make them work in small group? When you are going to have large group? When you have one student teaching the other student or learning from the other student? So this is another component. What material you are using, of course, you know, I don't have to talk about it. And what kind of evaluation you are going to do? Oral, written, project, assignment, do something, bring back and show me. Group assignment, they do something, make a big model of a volcano, for instance, to show how a volcano works. Fantastic. So much is possible. So all these five have to be in your mind as a good teacher when you are planning on accommodation. Now we can stop, Shilpa.
Shilpa, yes, ma'am. Over. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am, because as you said, it's a long session. I do not want our participants to go away with us. So I want them to be with us.
And, good teacher, Shilpa. That is why you thought of it.
Yeah. And dear participants, we have a small, we have a poll question for you, just to see whether you are with us or not. And meanwhile, Jayanti ma'am can also have 2 minutes break and we'll take up the questions. And you will see the poll question on your screen now. It is a true or false question. Please read the question and select the correct option.
Oh, you have worked on it, Shilpa. Nice.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's not a true or false question. It's a multiple choice question. I hope you are able to see the question. This has been covered by ma'am during her presentation. So inclusive education is acceptance, seeing strengths in the students, learning together, or all of the above. Yeah, we are seeing audience are giving in their votes. We almost have 130 plus people who are giving their options. We have around 85% who have selected all of the above. That means our audience are with us, madam.
Thank you.
They are very attentive. Obviously, when you are speaking, I'm sure nobody is going to, you know, have their attention.
No. Your question is a very common sense question. They would have answered it. Shilpa, don't forget, they're all teachers and they know. So what are
the Yeah, it would be also that, ma'am. I'm just a moment. I'm showing you all the results. I think all of you can see the results on your screen. The question, I hope, ma'am, are you able to see the bar which shows the results?
Oh, I have to come out of the PowerPoint, is it? How do I come to the screen? I'm still on the PowerPoint. I escape, is okay. It? I escape and... should I escape?
No, ma'am, let it be. Do you want to see this, ma'am? If you want to see it, then you have to stop sharing and then see the question.
Will it give problems?
I will announce the results. 78% have opted for all of the above. Around 16% have opted for learning together. Let me tell you, you are not wrong, dear participants. The moment we listen to inclusive education, the first thing which comes to our mind is all children learning together. So you are right, it is not a wrong answer. Rest assured, you are right. And around 4% have opted for acceptance. I would like to thank the participants who are also right, because it is accepting all children with all disabilities, with all strengths, with all differences. So your option is also a right option, but in the current context, all of the above would be the more appropriate option. Thank you for taking part in the poll. For those who have not seen the question on your screen, on your mobile screen, you will see a small bar graph. That is the polls. If you click on that bar graph icon, you will see the poll question. So I'll now hide this result and stop the poll. We'll take two questions, madam.
Sure.
Because we have audience connected in the YouTube also.
Okay.
I want them to be connected with us. So I'm taking the first question which has come up in the YouTube live chat.
Okay.
And the question is by Mr. Sandeep Kumar Das.
Okay.
And he is asking the question, what are the major thrust areas of NEP which ensures to make inclusive education universal? What are the major thrust areas?
Right from the introductory pages, if you see, the page number 5, I think, has a lot of highlights also on that. Every highlight, I mean, bolding. They have bolded certain words in the sentences. All of those starting with and going all the way through, particularly subsection 6, talks about the universalized concept, though it doesn't use the term universal, the concept of coming together to learn, it is running through all the way for us, the children with disabilities, particularly in 6. Subsection 6 contains it, but the mood of the whole NEP has that concept of highlighting on the one side the India ethos all the way through, but then universalization concept, you know, to have linkages with universities abroad and then have programs, higher education subsection, if you see, it talks about linkages with universities abroad. So we will also be one of the greatest knowledge sharing countries in the world. So it runs through all the way. Disability related is subsection 6. That you find.
Thank you, ma'am. And we'll now take a question from our participants who are connected live in Zoho. And we have a question by Mirza Riaz Ahmed, who's asking us regarding what's the striking difference between inclusive education and integrated education? Often there is a mix up in these both concepts.
I'm happy that you are asking about it once again. So I will be happy to tell you. We just went through it. Integrated education was an evolution to go towards inclusion, if you look at it that way. So years back, let us say when I was a student of special education, way back in 1970s, segregated education was there everywhere. Special schools is the only way for children with special needs. That was how it was. So we were all trained to be teachers in special schools, you see, those days. And children were sent only to special schools, no option. In 1980s, particularly 1984, this IED scheme came up in India, Integrated Education of the Disabled. The IED scheme said that children with disabilities, and also talking about NEP, NPE 1986, the one before the NEP 2020 that we had, NPE 1986, subsection 4.9, spoke about children with mild disabilities must study in regular education schools, and the moderate and severe disabilities will have special schools, and teachers must be prepared suitably, vocationalization, all those were part of it. So with that NPE, integration term came into existence. So integrated education meant that the special, carefully listen to me here, the difference you will see here. The integrated education meant that the special educators will prepare children in the special environment to be fit to be in the regular education schools. And the regular education teacher will just teach like she teaches her class. But the special child is may not be her focus. Whereas the special teachers prepare the regular, like training in Braille, for instance, or other lip reading strengths in the children with hearing impairment. So the children have to be prepared by the special educators and sent to the regular classroom. And regular children, as regular class children, as they learn, these children have to learn. The teacher herself was particularly not focusing on this child. And that also said that a school that has more than 8 children with different learning needs, the Ministry of Education supported them with one special teacher also. That scheme included that. So if a regular school has more than 8 children with special educational needs, they supported that school with one special teacher so that the regular teacher is not loaded. Special teacher stayed responsible for children with special needs in the regular education learning environment. Clear? This is integration. Then came the concept of inclusion, that is Right to Education Act, and then the RPWD, all of these acts coming together, inclusive, and also the Salamanca Declaration, whole lot of things happen, international mandates, if you look at it. Inclusive education terminology came into existence. Where, listen carefully, here comes the difference. The regular educator is responsible for a child with diverse learning need, a child with a disability, for the education. Onus is on to her. She will be supported by the special educator that is supplied through SSA, RMSA, now Samagra Siksha, whatever is the system in the government. So the teacher will be supported by a resource teacher or a special educator. But the onus of a child with a disability will be on the regular class teacher. The child has a right to study, a fundamental right with the Right to Education Act, in the school that he prefers to go and study. Not only to those schools where designated for them, but the child had the right to go to the school that he wanted to go to, and the school had the responsibility to educate him. And so the regular education took the responsibility, or is taking the responsibility, of children with special needs if he chooses to study in a regular school. Now the word choice is very important. Special schools are not closed. Special schools will exist. They'll continue to be there. The choice of the parents, if it is, even NEP 2020 says that if the choice of the student or the family is regular school, it is regular school. If the choice is special school, it is special school. The choice is home-based instructor, it is home-based instructor. So if the choice is made for regular education stream, yes, but Right to Education, all children need to get into one of these. So coming back to your question, summing it up, integrated education, the child needed to be prepared to enter a regular school. Inclusive education, child enters the school system is prepared to accept him as a student. And there's a very clear distinction between the two. As I told you, I repeat again, it's an evolution. We have evolved from integrated education into now the inclusive education system. I hope I have made myself clear.
Yes, ma'am, it is very clear. And I think many of the teachers who are working in the SSA system often come up with this particular doubt, exactly what is the thin line of difference between integrated and inclusive education. I think all the participants must have understood now. And before going for the next question, actually it's not a question, ma'am, it is a concern of one of the participant, which is very rightly stated. I also see his concern in this. Mr. E.S. Narayan has raised his concern that all the experts talk about curriculum adaptation, but no one explains how to do curriculum adaptation to different students with different disabilities. Can this be explained? So, Mr. Narayana, we would like to tell you that we have an exclusive session on curricular adaptation tomorrow by Dr. Nivedita Patnaik, wherein she will be talking about various aspects of curricular adaptations and how different needs of different children with different disabilities, varied disabilities can be addressed through curricular adaptations. So we have a complete exclusive session tomorrow. I would request you to stay connected with us tomorrow also. We have one more question, ma'am. I think we'll take this. I do not know whether Ms. Maumita Das, if she, Maumita Das, your mic is unmuted. You can ask your question directly. Maumita Das, can you hear us? Is your mic on, Maumita Das? Meanwhile, we have Mr. Khaja Moinuddin, who has raised the hand, ma'am. I am giving him the access control to speak. So if he gets connected to us, Mr. Guru Prasad, also your mic is also unmuted. If you have the question, you can ask the question directly to ma'am. Your mic is unmuted. Mr. Khaja Moinuddin, your mic is also unmuted. You can talk because you have raised your hand. Just in case if it is by mistake, you are exploring the feature, then please click it, double click. It will be automatically inactivated. Momit, I think they're not... Okay, ma'am, I think they're not. I think I'll take up the question which Ms. Maumit has asked. That is there a standardized lesson plan format? Okay, Ms. Maumita Biswas has answered that I am here. Maumita Biswas, is your mic on? We have unmuted you, ma'am. Just check your mic. We have unmuted you, so you can speak directly. We have actually unmuted, I've unmuted 3-4 people. Even Mahalakshmi Naidu, you are also unmuted. Just in case somebody doesn't answer, I have unmuted 5-6 people. Whoever can, mic is on, you can ask the questions. I think they are not. So the question is, ma'am, is there any standardized lesson plan format based on UDL which can be used by class teachers?
Okay. Because the needs of the children are different, it cannot be a format per se. But what you will be able to do is, like, look at the child's academic level of functioning, developmental level of functioning, and social level of functioning. All the three, when you are trying to make a lesson plan. So academic is, what is his level? Maybe he's sitting in class 4, but his academic learning level is like a class 1 child, for instance. So developmental level, does he require any adaptations in terms of hand function related or mobility related, speech related, vision related? So those is the second component. The lesson being what it is, you look at the child and first look at his academic status, then his developmental status, and third, the social status. So socially, is he a verbal, non-verbal, he communicates, and or he is friendly with others, or he disturbs the class. All the three needs to be looked at, keeping the topic that you are going to teach in mind. So therefore, look at the topic and these three and fit the child into these three. Suppose socially there is no issue. So then you know that peer tutoring components or group activities or your one-to-one teaching, all of these are not going to be a problem because the child does not have a social issue. Or there is a communication issue in him, he cannot reply. When you ask for your mode of teaching may slightly differ. You will not ask, what is this? Instead, you will ask, show me this in a group of material that you have given. So he points to that, you see. So your mode of teaching will change, but the question objective is the same. Suppose you want him to identify flag of India. Yeah. So you are showing him and asking, what is this? And he is non-verbal. So what will you do? You put many, many flags there. And then various countries' flags and say, show me in this flag of India. And so he's nonverbal and he's pointing to that, but still you are doing, the assessment is the same, but considering his capability of language and communication, you are giving him the choice. So the methodology undergoes change, you see. Now we come to academic. So academic, you are teaching about, let us say, the lesson is all about Independence Day. For this child, the goal that you set is that he is able to identify the date on which Independence Day happens, our flag, and what we do on that day. He can enact and show or whatever. Whereas other children, you may have the goal to say the national leaders and what they fought for, with whom did they fight. So the content changes. So the lesson is prescribed by your board of education, whatever is the board of education. From that lesson, you take these three in your template, developmental, social, and academic, and fit what is going to be this child's performance on that big lesson. We'll do it in a while, in little more examples when I get into UDL. But that is the way to go when it comes to planning, because there is no one template into which you can fit everything, because the needs of the children vary and the lessons complexity varies as they grow from class one to another. You see, so that is, but these three essentially help you. Developmental requirement, academic status, social status. Into that fit the lesson. Look at the lesson into that. I hope I have answered you. It works. Shilpa?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, I think I think we will continue with the presentation, ma'am. We'll stop the question and answers now and we'll continue the rest of the presentation.
Okay, thank you, Shilpa. All of you participants, you'll agree with me that Shilpa is a very good exam person. She gives a question and gives all right answers in it. She doesn't give a single wrong answer in it. They won't learn. I think all of us have teachers like that who will always pass us. No matter which of the MCQs we take, we are correct. Thank you, Shilpa, for being so teacher-friendly person that you are. We go ahead. Now we come to the universal design for learning. Already we have talked about it, why we need UDL. I gave you the history also as to why it is coined with the term UDL. It addresses their diverse learning needs because the needs vary. Don't look at only children who have a certificate of disability to say that he is a diverse learner. Even within the class who does not have a certificate of disability can have varied levels of their learning ability. Some may be visual learners, so when you write on board, they learn better. Some may be auditory learners. So even if you write on board, what you talk only makes them understand and then they are able to store it. Some may have very little attention that you need to keep on varying the things that you give. Continuously talk and then he gets lost. So these are all variables within the learning spectrum that we have in children. So don't think only the certified disability are the only people who have diverse learning needs. Some may be very, very quiet in class, not take part in class activities, question answers, putting up hand, nothing. But exam papers will be fantastic. So he may be very good absorber, but not so good a reflector in class. And there may be some, they are excellent reflectors in class, taking part in your question answers and group activity. While when it comes to writing examination, they may not be as good as they seemed to be in the classroom participation. You see the diversity? So the word diverse has come to stay. That is what is going to stay now in the educational stream. So when you use a UDL, all these children who are not labeled as diverse will also benefit. That's the beauty of UDL. Okay, the learning environment, home learning, school learning. Imagine yourself attending workshops somewhere, the traditional old kind of workshop, as against today where you are sitting or lying down or God knows what you are doing, but you are listening. But this is a learning environment. Definitely your quality of learning through this is very, very different from when you are attending a workshop. You know, going there and the presenter, listener interaction, all that is there, which, and your way, the way you sit doesn't change until there is a break. Whereas here you can do whatever and you are still listening perhaps. So the environment definitely influences the learning. So UDL addresses all of this. So CAST, Center for Applied Special Technology, is the one that initially came up with this idea of addressing the learner variability and allowing the learners to learn not through one single mode, but variety of modes. Yeah, the way you create your instructional goals, methods and material and your evaluations, all of them will not follow one single pattern. It will have a variety. The way you teach, the way you listen to the children when they reflect, and the way you give them the challenge level. The key word is flexible approach. If you see the NEP 2020, the flexibility is highlighted all the way through. Probably we are getting better days ahead where this special general education differences will merge to give us one way of teaching if NEP is implemented the way we think it should be implemented. So UDL allows you to teach in many ways, you know, multiple means of presentation.
Ma'am, just 1 minute, ma'am. Actually, I'm going to stop your screen sharing just for 2 minutes because in the YouTube live, they have a screen stuck. So I'll just refresh it once.
Okay,
so that they can also see your slide. So I'm going to... Yeah, ma'am. Can you please stop sharing once?
I have to stop sharing. Okay. Nah,
stop sharing once we can again start. I'll try to adjust that for the YouTube participants.
Yeah, I've stopped it. I just get some water for myself to drink.
Yes, sure. Okay, our dear YouTube live participants, we are working on the screen stuck. Just give us 2 moments. Are you able to see the program schedule? Please type in the message if you are able to see the program schedule. And we are trying to close that poll box. I think it was freezed. I think you are able to see the program schedule, right? Okay, sir, Zoho window, can
you?
Okay, you are able to see it in Zoho window. Okay. Please go to Zoho window once. Okay, I've changed the poll screen thing.
Okay.
1 minute. Mugesh sir, can you please check once on your screen because I think the window is screen freeze on the poll question. I have closed it on my window and it is not there. Hopefully it should get, or else you can refresh it once. Okay, ma'am, we are good. I think I'm giving you the presenter rights, Jayanti ma'am, now. You can start, or else if you want me to share the presentation, I'll share it from this end. Jayanti ma'am? Mugesh sir?
Hello.
See, I have closed the window, okay?
Okay.
The phone window. And again, okay. Jayanti ma'am is going to share the screen now.
I've said share, it's not sharing.
Yes, no, ma'am, it is. Now you can minimize this window and open the PowerPoint. Minimize the window.
Okay.
Yes, we are able to see the PowerPoint which is opened.
Yeah, ma'am, even, I think we are getting it from live.
Okay, now.
Yeah, it's okay in the Zoho. I think we are just checking in the YouTube. Yeah, it is okay, ma'am, now. Yeah, all good. Yeah.
Okay. So, we have come to the universal design. Simply means that we have the way we teach the students. We should have different ways of teaching. So, there are those, as I told you a few minutes back, those who are visual learners, perhaps, those who are auditory learners, those who learn by doing. You know, I'm saying not only children with disabilities, I'm talking of the whole class. So the way you take the lesson to the class also will have different ways of explaining a concept, not just using the blackboard and one model, but maybe many, many ways, maybe using themselves also as models to understand a concept. And then when the children want to respond back, you ask a question, and nowadays what we do in traditional classroom, you ask a question, children put up hand, you point to somebody, and that child answers. No, here you can give them opportunities to show that they have learnt in different ways. Some may draw and show, some may do a model and show, some may enact and show, some may give an answer verbally, some may like to write it out. So allow multiple ways of expression for the student. And third, very important when we talk of a diverse classroom, is different children may be at different levels. So the way you engage the children will be different. If a child is only at a counting stage, and if you are doing carryover addition, for instance, of two-line carryover addition, for instance, the child who is at the counting stage will get within 10 when you put together 2 and 3 in objects. It becomes 5, the counting and adding. With 2, you add 3 and then it becomes a 5. He may be at that level, and the others may be doing without carryover addition. There may be a few children. There may be a few children. You are teaching the whole class carryover 2-line addition. So the major number of children in the class may be doing the carryover addition line carryover addition, and you are teaching them that and they are doing, and still there may be children in your class, a small number, who would have finished the 2-line carryover addition like that and ready for a 3-line carryover addition. In the same class, you may be able to give them the 3-line or a 3-digit carryover addition. So engaging the children at the level in which they are performing. So it's a bell curve like this. You see, majority fall in the 2-line carryover addition because that's what you are teaching. Some who are a little slower on one side and some who are faster than that on the other side. And you will engage them as a teacher at their level of functioning. Otherwise, what will this boy do who is a 2-line carryover addition? Very fast he has finished. Others are still doing. Majority are still doing. He'll start to fiddle around with others. He may be a disturbing person in the class. So the children in the faster learning spectrum also become your concern to keep them engaged. And then those who are in a slower learning pace also. Or the faster learning child, maybe you'll do a peer tutoring by taking him and bringing him to the one-to-one learning child who is very slow in learning. Very many ways of handling the situation, you see. So idea is multiple ways of giving input, multiple ways of allowing children to respond back to say they have understood, multiple levels of engaging children. So why it is so, this is what CAST is giving us as a justification. So they stimulate the motivation and sustained enthusiasm for learning by promoting various ways. So each child is kept at his best of performance level. That is the multiple levels of engagement. Each child is kept at his best performing and leading to challenging level of engagement. So the counting child cannot do carryover addition. He cannot even do without carryover addition. So he is still at counting objects level. And that is challenging and engaging for him. Whereas other kid who can even do three-line and three-digit carryover addition. So that should be the worksheets given to him. So your engagement, very, very important point, right? And the next one, multiple means of representation. Present information and content in a variety of ways to support understanding by students with different learning styles and ability. Here comes, I was telling you, the visual learner, the auditory learner, the tactile by doing learner, so that all of these, your various lobes in the brain responsible for, your temporal lobe, your occipital lobe, that's what is showing. So which is, try and give input through also, no child is left out. Each one of us have a different strength in our learning style. And then expression involves your memory recall. So the frontal lobe has been highlighted here. So memory recall and your verbal or written, the motor components in your system. When you talk of expression, it is a motor component in your system. So first absorption happens. And then the reflection happens. Multiple means of representation leads to absorption. And multiple means of expression leads to your reflection of what you have learned. So based on this theory, go to the CAST website, all of you. You will really find a lot of wonderful material there, even on top. So how the brain network works now, as you have seen here, how the various parts of the brain work for what? Multiple means of engagement is a motivation and all that is in the inside, where both the hemispheres work together for it. Then you have the representation and expression. This network, to get the best of it, you have your input. Input, what happens? The brain recognizes. So you are passing on a content to your student group. And the brain recognizes the material and the brain tells you, hey, mujhe pehle se pata hai, naya kuch nahi hai. Oh, ye toh kuch naya hai, seekhne ka hai. Ah, ye mujhe zaruri nahi hai. Something your brain tells. So the recognition happens and then the brain says, this is important. Something new I'm learning. No, this is not important for me. No, this I already know. Right? If you already know it, your brain tells you that. So that is what happens when you are giving in the content to a student. And then what happens? The output, the various strategies that you are using, and therefore the child has understood and he is putting it out. I have understood this. This is what you taught me, teacher. So you make out whether the child has understood it correctly or child has made a mistake, which you are correcting so that his presentation is superior. So then the second loop. Then the third point is, repeatedly I'm saying, different levels of your teaching within a classroom. Different children get different, the same content, different complexity of the content, depending on the child's ability to absorb, ability to store and reflect. Yeah. So the content complexity varies of the same topic that you are teaching so that all children in the class are engaged at a level that is meaningful to him, keyword, at a level that is meaningful to him. So this is all is UDL, basically, when we look at it. Now, how do we go about? Take a lesson, for instance, respiratory system. It's in class 4, let us say. We already spoke about digestive, so I'm coming to respiratory system. Class 4. Respiratory system. In this lesson, read, you teacher first read the lesson. What all children will learn? Majority of children will learn what are the respiratory organs and how respiration happens, what is the role of the nose and what happens when it reaches the lungs, perhaps, and then how the heart pumps in the impure blood to the lungs, and then the new oxygen that is going in through the breathing cleans and then brings out the carbon dioxide, and the cleaned blood goes back to heart to be distributed. This is the lesson. So most of the children will know the organs of respiration. Blood gets purified because of our breathing, and breathing is important for survival. When breathing stops, we are no more. Maybe up to that, most children or all children in the class may understand. Most children probably will also know that blood gets purified. You know, the other children will just know the organs perhaps, but then this group of children will know it's a process required, oxygenating the blood, and blood gets purified, and the lungs are the organ that does that and all that. And very few children in your class might have understood the process of how the blood, impure blood from the heart comes to the lungs, and how it gets oxygenated, the white blood gets the water, and then how it goes back to the heart, and then how it goes back to the body. So some children learn more than respiratory system. They get into the circulatory system understanding also. Relevant circulatory system understanding. Some children understand how respiratory system works. All children understand organs responsible for respiration. What are the organs and what they do? See that? So these are the three levels of children you are likely to have in the classroom. Remember this. The last question that I had from you, is there a template for making the lessons? This is what it is. Your mind has to group your children in this manner. What is it that I'm going to say? Everybody gets it. Of the total lesson. What is it that some of the children will get? And just like the carryover addition, ordinary addition, only counting, three-digit addition. How just carryover addition had a side that is above your expectation and below your expectation, but the whole thing is to do with addition, you see? Similarly, the whole lesson is on respiration. But then there are three levels of children learning that in your class, but you are not deviating and giving something other than respiration to any of the children in the class. Even if they have the intellectual disability, they are still with you in respiration. Take this example. I just took another example for you because you are asking me for example. Your goals must be very, very clear. What is it that I want to achieve at the end of my class? Germination of a seed to a plant. If that is what it is, what all children, your first question is, what all children will learn? Seeds become plant. Plants need mud into which I have to put it. Plants need sunlight. They take time to grow. So these may be the basics all children, and they need sunlight and they need this. Some children might know even how the germination happens by the seed getting, you know, time to germinate, how long it takes, how it comes out of its husk. So very, very few children will understand the total mechanism of the germination. But the lesson is on germination. The same pyramid works there also for you. So set goals very firmly. For different levels of children, your goals are different. Just name that a seed becomes a plant and then it takes time, it requires mud and sunlight and water. Maybe that is all a child is capable of learning. Fine, give it to him. And then provide many ways to achieve the goal. Like we said, really plant, put it in one seed you have planted, you put it in the window that gets the sunlight. Another one jar, you put it where there is no sunlight. So after some time, both are watered, or one, the third one that is in sunlight but gets no water. Three, all the three are in your classroom. See, let the children observe which one grows better. So you are multiple, you are giving learning experience differently. And each one, you will see that all children are involved and specific to the student. Give them options to understand the concept and reflect on it. Is there a problem, Shilpa? Somebody is talking continuously. Is there a problem?
Dear participants, please unmute your microphones, because in between it is getting collided with ma'am's voice. Please unmute your microphones.
I thought you were telling me something. There is a problem.
No, ma'am. Absolutely. It is clear, but somebody's microphone is on. So that is the voice which we are listening in between.
Okay. So now, use of technology. All of you, I think, have understood how the UDL works. It's very, very simple. When you hear people say UDL, 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 everybody gets it something rocket science. No, just adjust your teaching to fit all the children and make many, use many methods of teaching, many methods of evaluation, many methods of engagement. That's what it is. And you are addressing all the children in the class by this. So use of technology, teachers' role nowadays is changing because technology has come in so much. Unlike the olden days where teacher prepares a lesson and teach, nowadays teacher is a facilitator because children get all the information from the net. You just give them a project. By tomorrow, all of you children come back to tell me one festival of each state in the country. If you tell one festival celebrated in each state in the country is specific to that state, children will come tomorrow, one Google, and they will have all pictures and everything and videos. They will be in your class flooded with the festivals of India, right? So teacher's role is changing to become only a facilitator rather than a teacher. Give them the questions, allow them to find answers and come. Exploration and self-learning is what is going to stay. It has come to stay and it is going to be there. And so use technology optimally. Accessibility facilities in ICT should be effectively used with smart boards and all that you are having in the class. And everything can be shown live. You can show to a child what an earthquake is, what a tsunami is, what a volcano is, and how is Bihu celebrated in Assam. Everything you can show live, like a video in your classroom for children to understand. No need for sitting and explaining. So use technology effectively and allow as much as possible cooperative learning among children so they explore, they find answers. NEP 2020 talks a lot about critical thinking and independent learning. So cooperative learning assists in critical thinking among children. So use as much as possible. Use variety of material. All the activities, when you plan an activity, think in what way it will help me achieve my goal. Then only select. Flexibility in grouping children, vary your goals based on children. This is summing up because I've talked about it already. Use your assessment data for further teaching. Encourage critical thinking. Make sure no child is left out in that lesson. Allow the student to select an activity. Ask them, this is what today we have to learn, children. What activities can we do to learn about this? Ask them. Fantastic answers you will get. And then you will help them learn also based on that. Malala Yousafzai, I'm sure all of you know the Nobel Prize winner, young girl. One child, one teacher, one book, one pen can change the world. And you are all the teachers for that one child. You as one teacher, you think about yourself only. Don't look at a teacher group. I, one teacher. But with one child, one book, and one pen, if every teacher thinks so, we'll change the world. These are some references. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for the wonderful presentation. No, we are on time, ma'am. We started around 15 minutes late. So we are well within time. It is just... I think 12:28 in my watch, and we'll take a few more questions. Audience,
can I stop sharing so I come to the main screen?
Yes, yes, ma'am. You can stop sharing.
Okay.
Now, audience, the question and answer session is on. You can type your questions in the chat box. Or else you can raise hand also. We have already unmuted few of you. And if you see your mic activated, you can click on it and you can start speaking to ask the question. I will just announce whose mics we have unmuted. We have unmuted Dr. Simi Srivastava. We have also unmuted... Usha, Amar, did you unmute this? We have also unmuted... Vijay Das 04, you also have a connection now to speak. Ms. Bhavani, then Ms. Vardhi Venkateshwar, your mic is also on. Yeah, if you can listen to me, all the names which I've just said, Ms. Bhavani, Vijay Das, Vardhi Venkateshwar, and Dr. Simi, then Mugana Vijay. Your mic, please, if you want to ask a question, you can ask the question directly.
Yeah, Shilpa, can I ask the question?
Yes, Dr. Simi, so glad to hear your voice.
Yeah, a very good afternoon to Jayanti, madam. It was very, very effective today, whatever we have learned from you, UDL. I just wanted one question to be answered from you, ma'am. I am more interested in the learning disabled children. So how we can implement the UDL concepts with the learning disabled children. So can you just give us a small gist of like whatever you have taught? Yes, we will be using it in for the children, but specifically I wanted for LD children, SLD children. So can you just help me out, ma'am, in this?
Yeah. So the beauty of UDL is that it fits anyone, right? So the thing that I told you, the developmental, social, and academic. So take a lesson and take this child, match both of them. If this is the lesson, and socially his status and developmentally his status, and then come to academic. So when you come to academic, predominantly we have problems in academics only with these children, right? So look at the lesson. And look at his or her level in terms of whether he is a visual learner or an auditory learner or and what are the remedial efforts you are taking in terms of omission, addition, substitution, reversal, any of those. Is he having all of these come under the category called academic, right? And here is the lesson. So once the lesson is there and you also identified what is his profile? So in the classroom, because he is more an auditory learner and not so good in putting things down in writing, but an oral response person. And he learns as soon as you teach him verbally, he's able to learn, look at things and hear and learn, but not so good in responding. So his output, you know, UDL will be predominantly by oral or doing and not demanding that he writes. Some of the children who are not so good in writing, they are all now given the keyboard and laptop where they use their fingers to get the right spelling and use the words support of underlining and right-clicking to correct the spelling. So they don't worry about the spelling or grammar. They start typing and then they keep correcting. You have writing difficulty are compensated with the laptops also to give their responses or oral responses we take. The idea is multiple modes of presenting and multiple modes of getting them to reflect back. So based on the child's level, you'll have to do it. Suppose he's a child who has ADHD, doesn't sit at one place, and his attention level is not beyond 1 minute. Have a variety of activities on the same concept so that he gets opportunity to get and move you see, and then come back, and so it is inbuilt into the activity and the topic is not undergoing change, topic remaining the same. He gets a chance to if you are doing things in class, he'll get an opportunity to go and come. If you're teaching about the respiratory system, he's the one who's going to go and fetch the model of your lungs and heart and all and put it on your table, go back and sit, for instance, for which you're going to thank him. So he's part of class and he gets to move around and there is a purpose. So the movement is not a problem, but you regulate it to be meaningful. So like that for each one, we have to keep building up. It works. In fact, it works best with LD. Because of all of these ICT support, they use it very effectively. Understanding is superior in them. Unlike ID children, they understand better. The route that they take for understanding is what you are concerned about. Is he an auditory learner? Is he a visual learner?
Yes,
this is very, very important to find out. So what is now, what is his output channel? If you know that, you will start using them effectively.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much for giving me the most important criteria of how to go about teaching SLD children. One more problem is that, ma'am, ki when we are dealing with the children and the parents in the remote areas, so we are unable to get that kind of an matlab explanation through WhatsApp or photographs, or because they don't have the access to this ICT system. So it is becoming very difficult for us to teach the children in the remote areas or even in the rural areas. So I think how are we going to manage teaching children in the remote areas, because our teachers, special teachers, are also there to help them out, but getting access is a big difficulty, because now the special schools are closed, and then we have to only contact through telephones most of the time. So telephonic explanation is sometimes very, very tiring for the special teachers also, and sometimes even the teachers, I mean the parents also, don't have this much time to listen to us and then go according to what we are suggesting them for the children. So how can we sort out this kind of a problem which is existing every day, ma'am?
The current situation is abnormal school environment, no, even for children mm-hmm. without a disability. This COVID-19 situation is not a routine teaching learning environment. It's an abnormal situation right now.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
The maximum possible that we can tell the parents, we tell them. And then if your teacher is reaching them with the gadgets or personal visits or whatever, they'll have to carry the message. The idea is very simple, not to use only one method of teaching for learning. That is all is UDL all about. And understand the child. You see, through that, whatever innovatively you can use, you are welcome to use. Keeping that principle in mind. Not necessary, you must have gadgets all the time. No, you can teach just with what is available. I'll tell you, in one of the schools that I happened to see when my grandson entered class UKG. The teacher, first day of the school, this is in Maryland, Washington, D.C. First day of the school, all children are new to school. And the teacher simply had three bowls of magnet of shoes, pair of shoes, school bus and car, magnets of these. And then she stood near the board. She asked the children, those of you who came to school by walking, put up your hands. And for they got up and stood or stand up. So each child, she said, named the child and said, this shoes is you. This shoes is you. This shoes is you. She kept on building like a tower, that many children. And then similarly, she asked for the bus children and the car children. Never she used one number name. Never she used number name. For each child, she identified each child with the mode they took for reaching the school. And asked the children, look at the board and tell me which mode of reaching school was maximum today. Which mode was taken maximum? Which mode was taken least?
Okay.
The children were the members. And each child identified himself or herself on the board. The teacher identified. She never said long, short, more. The board list was the only thing that she taught. No number name. You are number one, number two, number four. This bar has 15 shoes. That bar has 12 buses. This bar has 7 cars. Nothing.
Okay.
But end of the day, she got them the concept of graph, bar graph at
very
UKG.
Nice.
For teaching it can be anything. That and how I came to know, the little boy, 4-year-old boy, comes home, he narrated the whole thing and I understood. That means how good the teacher has been, that the child could reflect.
Yeah.
He said, walking children were maximum today to school. I said, how do you know? Then he said, our teacher did this in the class today. So the shoes was the highest bar. Car was the smallest one. School bus was in the middle. Look at that, how the children learn.
Yeah.
So we don't need gadgets and material. Children were the subjects themselves. And teachers not use 1, 2, 3, 4. Very important. Pre-math concept of more and less or tall and short were the two things with which the teacher got them to understand what we learn in class 4 as x-axis and y-axis and bar graph.
Very true. Very nice. Yeah.
मेकैनिक विद टूल्स इन हैंड ही सेंटेंस आई हैड पुट इट एट एनआईएम शिल्पा विल रिमेंबर दैट आई हैड पुट इट इन अवर स्टाफ रूम that obstacle is a thing that you see only when you take your eyes off your goal.
Yeah, very true.
That is why Ford cars are Ford cars today. Obstacle is a thing that you will see only when you take your eyes off your goal. Jaise Arjuna was having only the parrot's eye in his focus, so he did not see anything else. To reach the child, full stop. Nothing else is an obstacle. That attitude we have to develop.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it is easy. बहाना चाहिए मुझे नहीं करने के लिए सोचेंगे तो बहाना हजार मिल जाएगा.
Very true.
करना ही करना है लेंगे तो कुछ रास्ता में नहीं आ रहा है करेंगे.
Yeah.
That's the idea. We have to be focused. Situation is so bad. You are all coping. All of you teachers are coping so beautifully with online learning. Who taught you online learning? Our BEd, DEd, BM are nothing taught online learning. How are you all coping? You learn.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
So that is the spirit. Ultimately, it is all in our spirit. How yes, we reach.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for answering this question. And thank you, ma'am. It was a very comprehensive lecture and session today, ma'am. It was really very nice. And we can maybe request to have your PPT presentation, ma'am, if we want to. Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you,
Dr. Shimi.
Thank you, Shilpa.
I would request you to please mute your mic now. And we will take others' questions. Thank you so much. Ma'am, I would like to make an announcement that the attendance form has been shared in the chat box. If you are not able to open it, please wait. We will send the attendance link in the WhatsApp groups where you have registered. So do not worry. We will send the link in the WhatsApp group also. Meanwhile, I have one poll question. So for the audience, you will see the poll question on your screen. Please answer, select the right option. It's a true or false question. For those who are not able to see, I will read out the question. UDL addresses the various variations and diversities in learning among students. If you think the statement is true, please select the option true. If you think the statement is false, you can select the statement false. For the information of the participants, tomorrow also we will start at 11 o'clock itself, and we will give you the joining links in the WhatsApp, and you'll also receive emails. So please stay connected with us. In 2 hours from now, you will receive the updates. You will receive all the updates after 2 hours. Please give us time to make arrangements. Okay. Yes, ma'am. As we can see, almost 95% have said true. I'm showing the results to the attendees. I think you will be able to see the result on your screens now. Yeah. 95% have agreed to the statement. Yes, it does address the variations and diversities which are existing among the students. I'm stopping.
4% need a little more of exposure to UDL, I think, so that they will also be convinced. So 4 became 3 now.
Yes, ma'am.
Little more of exposure they need, it will work.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
I'm just curious about this question here. Specialty teachers of 10 to 12 special students of different classes, of different levels, and of different disabilities. Are they all not in regular class? Are they all segregated and taught? I don't understand how they make a statement like this. Will UDL work? UDL work in any, you will work in any class. You'll have to know how to apply UDL. But why are they saying 10 to 12 special students of different classes, of different levels? So do they pull out all of them separately into one classroom, teach them?
Yes, ma'am. Most of the time, it happens that they are pulled out. And that's the reason that question has come. Especially,
that's not inclusion then. That is not at all inclusion. They have to work in regular classrooms with the teacher. So even in a situation like this, because they are all diverse learners, even in a situation like this, if they know how to plan,
that's true.
The subject should be the same subject at one time. If it is science, it is science. If it is math, it is math. If it is language, it is language. And different children at different levels, they should be able to apply UDL. But that's not a nice way of segregating children, teaching, and then sending them back. Anyway, I just wanted clarification on that.
Ma'am, we have a question from a newly recruited teacher, Ms. Asin, Sheikh Yasmin. Okay, and she says that she is a new teacher in an enclosed classroom and she is feeling overwhelmed. She wants to know what are the first things I should focus on to get onto the right track in the inclusive classroom.
What to focus on?
Yeah.
Is that what she's saying?
Yeah, what to focus on?
The first is to stop looking at them as children with deficits. So they just look at them as children who are a little different in their learning. They don't learn like others. And two is identify what style of learning suits best for them. Yeah. And they are students like anybody else in the classroom. So that should be number one. And then look at their strengths. What is the strength in the child that you can cash on for training that student? Yeah. So if these three are looked at, don't magnify the disability is number one. Look at the strength in the child and see what mode of learning he learns better. In various methods, you try and see which method suits him better in terms of learning and retaining. If these three are kept in mind as basic, any student will be able to deal with and teach. Did I answer that?
This question was asked by one of the participants who is connected with us in the YouTube. I just want to ensure we are going YouTube live. This is the third time, and we just want to ensure that our YouTube participants do not feel left alone. So I'm picking up the questions which are coming from the YouTube live streaming chat box. So that doesn't mean that the Zoho participants are left out. Your questions are all recorded. We will get back to you through email if any of your question is not answered. I could see some of the questions which are talking about IEP planning, which also are asking questions about does UDL work with children with severe disabilities. These questions have all been answered during the presentation itself. Just now, ma'am has emphasized once again that UDL works with all students. It's only the right planning which we have to do. I think first thing is that we need to get away with this feeling, this is a severe child and he may not be able to benefit from it. As long as we go with the IQ levels and all, I do not think we'll be planning in the right manner. So my appeal to all the special educators is that look at the strengths of the child, look at the strengths of the students, and then see all the various ways of engagement, how you can really keep them engaged in the class. I hope those are the questions, ma'am. There is one more question which is coming. We are just taking out the question. Meanwhile, we have unmuted A. Shailaja, also D.L. Narayanamma. Would you like to ask a question? Because your mics are unmuted. If you want to ask a question, please start speaking. Miss Subhadrama, your mic is also unmuted. No, I don't think they want to ask a question. I see somebody.
It's overwhelming because it is totally against the principle of UDL. That is number one, content is new for them. UDL itself is new. Number two, the method of representing is only one mode, that is this video mode. We are not using any other. Like if I were to conduct a workshop on UDL, I'll divide them into small groups, work on a topic, come back and present, each group presents something, then the understanding also will be superior. You see, this current presentation that is happening is exactly the opposite of UDL style of working because it is only online. Mode of input is only online. And therefore, they also will have confusion. I'm totally understanding their concerns and confusions. If the same thing in future after the COVID-19, if we all get an opportunity to have a hands-on workshop, and same Shilpa and I will be there to conduct the workshop for you, multiple modes of representation, multiple modes of input from us and output from you, and also the multiple modes of engagement, different groups doing different things, and you people will come back to say, yes, it worked, you know. So, yeah, what we are doing right now is exactly anti-UDL way of doing, but that's not available with us now. So, I understand your question. Some of the questions I am reading, I understand your confusion, but we'll have another some other time. Yeah,
so yes, ma'am. Yeah, I think UDL is such a vast topic that a 1 hour session is not really going to make all the concepts clear. We should definitely have an very comprehensive 3 days or 4 days workshop exclusively on UDL where we can directly interact with a small group of participants, not such a large group. Otherwise, we may not be able to
Put them into small groups and it with them. So there may be a group of science teachers working on science, math teachers working on math, language. Like that, we form small groups and then we'll give you a simulated, your class has this many children who cannot see, this many children with learning disability, this many children who have ID, and this is the lesson. Now come on, prepare a lesson using UDL principles, then demonstrate. So like that, when we conduct a workshop, you will get that, aha, I understand, that moment will come in you.
Yes, very true.
This is just a beginning. So we'll meet again sometime. Yeah, and then we will do it face to face when this COVID-19 finally leaves us and goes away. Then we'll all come together and do it. Yeah?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. And I just want to make an announcement for the participants that tomorrow's our session is on curriculum adaptations by Dr. Nivedita Patnaik. I'm just showing the slide so that all of you get to know that what is the tomorrow session. I'm now stopping.
Before that, Shilpa, there is this question, you can answer it yourself. The difference between, let us not leave this candidate go without a clarity. Radhika Bodhi, what is the difference between slow learner and learning disability? Will you answer it yourself?
I'm not able to see the question over here.
Radhika Bodhi. What is the difference between slow learner and learning disability? Very important question to be answered. You want to answer?
I would request you to
one more question. The same person has asked it again. Is slow learner comes under learning disability? The same person has asked this once again. So, slow learners are not covered by any of our RPWD Act or anything, but definitely RTE covers them because they have a right to education. They are people who have an IQ between 70 and 90. Below 70 IQ, people are those who are termed as intellectually disabled. Above 90 is considered to be coming in the spectrum of average or above average intelligence. So the kids in between, and they don't come in the disability category. Specific learning disabilities included in RPWD. Average intelligence, but they have difficulty in learning, and there is special set of tests for them. They are not slow learners. They are another category of people. They have been they will be tested for their learning ability. They have average intelligence, good eyesight and hearing and locomotor, everything seemingly normal, but difficulty in academics. This is the difference, Radhika Bodhi, for between the slow learner and learning disabled. Just thought we'll clarify that. Yeah. Thank you, Shilpa. I don't want somebody leaving with this question in mind, you know, without...
Yeah, now I'm seeing the questions now. I couldn't see those questions on my screen. So I was just trying to locate them earlier. Thank you so much for answering those questions, ma'am. I think since it's going to be one, we will stop the questions over here. Thank you, participants, for joining us. And I would request Dr. Chandrika, ma'am, if you are online. Dr. Chandrika, yes, ma'am. Can you hear us? Dr. Chandrika, ma'am, Deputy Director from Samagra Siksha.
Okay.
Ma'am, your mic is muted. I'm unmuting Chandrika, ma'am. Oh, I think they... Yeah, we can see you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I'm just, am I visible?
Yes, ma'am, you're visible and you're audible also. In the beginning.
Madam Jayanti, ma'am. Thank you very much,
yes,
madam,
able
for
to
your
see you.
Beautiful words. The what we need actually in order of inclusive classrooms, and I'm very happy to hear a lot of important things and strategies that are needed, especially in this particular classroom. Thank you very much, madam. I hope all the attendees who have attended to this particular program are able to understand the and that should be included in the classrooms. Thank you, Shilpa. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the opportunity to be with all of you.
Thank you, ma'am.
And thank you so much, Jayanti ma'am, for the wonderful session. And participants, we will meet tomorrow. Please stay connected with us in the WhatsApp group. We will send you the updates. And you can click the exit button and leave the webinar now. You will see the exit button at the end and you can click that and then you will leave the webinar. And thank you to all our viewers in the YouTube live. Please get rest assured you are connected with us and we have all the chat history. If there is any question which is unanswered, we will get back to you through email. Thank you so much. Thank you one and all.
Thank you, Shilpa, for making this easy to happen. And thank you all. Thank you, ma'am, for making me part of your effort in the state government's effort towards inclusive education. Thank you, all participants. See you sometimes. All the best to all of you.
You can also exit the button, you can click it, ma'am, and we will end. We are ending the webinar now.